good evening to everybody. All around, man. Good evening, everybody, in Amy, Tangipahoa Parish, Louisiana as a state, and the country as a whole, man. Thank you guys for tuning in to Real Talk Kingdom Discussions. Different format, different agenda today. As we give you guys a few minutes to log on live, please be interactive today. I'm able to view your comments as you send them real time, and as we can, we will respond to them, and we will answer any questions to the best of our ability. So as we give you guys just a few minutes to log on live, get ready to get this thing going, man.
Master somewhere.
Things are
bound to get better as the days go on. Make America great again. I think they knew it was great. For them, it wasn't so great for everyone back then. So when I can have all the money and the fame and they still don't care. Cause if I get pulled over, I still gotta live in fear.
Thank you for being so patient with us. We're a little bit after the time that I chose, but it's not unusual. But if you notice in the caption, the title is Real Talk, Kingdom Discussion, George Floyd, Black and Blue, so on and so forth, etc. Self-explanatory, but really I could go on and on. So that's why I say so on and so forth, etc. You could have said blah blah blah, whatever you want, but we can see this same story played on our TVs and on our screens for years. Seems like it's been continuous. But before we get started with this show, because we have such a large panel, I'm going to let everybody on the panel introduce themselves to some of you who may be the first time watching Real Talk. We're going to start from my right, which is your left, and we're going to go all the way around, and he's going to pan the room. So start with Pastor Water, introduce yourself and just let them know who you are and what brought you here today.
My name is Pastor Water Dyson, Pastor of Redemption Outreach Ministries, AB native, AB High School alumni, came here today in order to get some real views, some real talk, and some real issues about the situation. Bless.
Great. Of course, my name is Horace Martin, host of Real Talk with Martin and Gardner, co-host. But right now, we've been doing a Real Talk Kingdom Discussions, and it's just been myself leading it, but I'm pretty certain once my brother Christopher get done doing some of the things he's been trying to do outside of school and with school, he'll be joining us again. But again, I'm the co-host of the show, and I'm glad to be here. You know what I do, we always do this, so thank you for tuning in. Moving on.
My name is Andre Harrison. I'm a loving father, husband, and I'm a worship area director at UCFM. That's United Christian Faith Ministries. I'm also a real estate agent, and I also have my own production company, Big Drake Productions, but I'm happy to be here. I'm inspired to talk about some of the issues that we have right now and to bring some hope to our nation, hope to our people, and bring some unity and love to it.
Awesome.
How y'all doing? My name is Gil Muse, and I'm a slave for Jesus. And I was motivated to come out and speak today because I have some solutions that I would like to offer. Some things that I feel like if we can implement them, we can become better as a people. Thank you.
Awesome. Good afternoon. My name is Coach Ventura, AMI High School alumni, current Southeastern senior. I was asked by Horace to come out here and give my opinion and my view from the standpoint of a youth, a young African-American male in America today. And I'm just really motivated to, you know, see what y'all saying on the Facebook feed and just, you know, try to get a few solutions and a few answers to y'all questions.
Most.
My name is Therese. I came to
put in my two cents. It's a lot going on. I just want to always enforce the Lord, His Spirit, and I want to encourage and empower and just take heed to what's going on and stay woke.
At this time, I will do a little brief intro, and then we'll have a word of prayer, and we're going to dive into the show. As the country is trying to ease its way back into operation from the coronavirus pandemic, we have been sideswiped by the unfortunate death of George Floyd at the hands of another police officer for actions that clearly did not warrant the excessive and ultimately deadly force used by the officer. Now as the country lashes out in anger, we are still in the midst of phase one of the coronavirus pandemic and the government's slow reopening process of our country. So while we still deal with losses due to corona, we have an ongoing epidemic and fatal encounters by black men with the police that seem to be only growing in number and rate over the last few years. So as we get started, if you first time watching this show, we have our Real Talk signs. These Real Talk signs are for several different reasons. For one is when it's time to get real. If we, filling around on the surface and we ain't deep enough, pull that sign up and let's get a little deeper. If you think that you agree with what somebody's saying on this, we'll pull the signs up. And the last one is to interject when you just feel like, man, that ain't it, man. Come on with it. So Real Talk, if you see us do this here, we finna get with it. That's all that means. That's all these signs represent for us. And it's real, man. There's no way I could have called myself having any kind of internet show, podcast, whatever you want to call it, and not touch on this. This is real talk. Normally right. We do our kingdom discussions, but this is kingdom discussions.
Kingdom discussions. Yes. Yes.
We just took a detour from our regular format, and it was worth it, and it's warranted. And I've been throughout the week when I could, I've been trying to, make sure I was prepared for it. I could have freestyled for a good portion of it, but some things you want to be able to, you want to lay them out factually, and you want some statistics as well. So throughout the show, we will be going over some of those. It's lined up good, some of the format. Most of them don't know the format. So I did that on purpose so that it will be authentic answers. And I want them to think on the spot on some of them. Some of them I know they prepared their angle and what they wanted, their perspective, and their viewpoint of everything going on, from the riot, from the killing, the death of it, to the riots, to what he was charged with, to what we think is going to happen to him, all of that. So I try to encapsulate all of that into today's show. Today's show, I'm not going to tell you it's going to be an hour, because I just know it won't. It's too many panel members for everybody to get their own time to talk. That's not going to happen, but I'm not concerned about that. And if somebody got to leave, they can excuse themselves and leave. We're going to continue until we complete what we're trying to complete today. So before I dive any deeper into it, I want to have a word of prayer by my brother Andre. And would you help me and celebrate his birthday today, man? Today's his birthday, man. When I asked him to be on the show last week, I wasn't thinking about this was his birthday. So I kind of verified with him again this morning. Say, hey, man, you still think you're going to come? And he said, I'm still coming. And happy birthday to you, man. I love you, dog.
Happy birthday.
We over the 40s now, so, you don't need once you hit 40 the first time, it's the other ones, they start coming quicker, man. But he made 41 today. And, he's my little brother, but he ain't no little brother, though. He's grown, man. Glad he's here, man. He could have been doing anything on the day, but he took time out of his special day to come and share some light from his perspective and viewpoint on what is going on today. So without further ado, Andre, could you please lead us in a word of prayer?
Father, we thank you for another day that we can wake up and see clouds in the sky. We thank you, Lord God, for breath that we breathe. We thank you, Lord God, for our mechanicals, how we function, how we walk, how we talk. Lord, we ask you today, Lord, to give us wisdom. Give us your Holy Spirit to be able to speak to your people.
Yes, Lord.
To speak to the people that you know and the people that you don't know and that don't know you. Help us, Lord, to give them your perspective, your kingdom, help them know that there's hope for their for their, there's answers for their questions, and there's hope for their lives.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Lord God, for whatever we say today, Lord, it bring you glory.
Yes.
And also, Lord, give a perspective and give wisdom, and also give, Lord, clarity to what people are thinking.
Yes,
and what we need to do to prepare for the next stage, and what we need to do to prepare for the next phase of life, and how we deal with it as a people, as a human race, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Covered in your blood. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. I want to acknowledge a few of our viewers right quick before we get too deep into it. I got Tyler Velasa, however you pronounce that last name. Thank you for being on here. Althea McNeilton Perkins, Corey Walford, Jennifer Richmond, Catrice Richmond. That's our cousin, Sharpen. Suela Martinez, Matt Patelli, thank you. Trail Butler, Christopher Gard, Larry T. Cipran, my other brother, Alvin Cipran, thank you, man, for tuning in. It's going to be a wonderful show, man. I hope you guys get something from it. It's really not nothing that we are here trying to boast and call ourselves these great orators and great speakers. We just normal, regular, everyday black men, different age demographics, with our own particular viewpoints. It was intentional for me to try to mix up the panel with the age differences. And if I could have got some even younger, I would have, but I do have some out here. And I'm thankful for all of them taking time out of their busy day to be here. So as we dive into the show, and I know they introduced themselves, but I want to give them another 30 to 45 seconds to try to encapsulate real briefly to the audience just exactly what they want them to leave with today, from their perspective. So I'm gonna start to my right with Pastor Wardell Dyson. 30 to 45 seconds, what do you want the audience to leave with today, after, you know, from your perspective?
I want the audience to leave with today that it's not about us. It's about the Jesus that's on the inside of us. We have to go at this thing from a kingdom perspective and a kingdom mindset in order to get the justice that God has ordered for our life.
Awesome, awesome. Real briefly, you know, I was urged, man, by the Spirit, just by my natural blackness, you know, by my heritage, the lineage that I come after, to make sure that I did something, you know. And I know right now in these times we kind of feel a little helpless, because you know it's kind of big. So you wonder how to tackle stuff like this collectively. And I don't know the exact answer, but I do know that it does start at home individually. And when it starts at home individually with your family, your immediate family, and it spreads abroad, at least, see, you have to have the kind of faith that they had when they used to sing hymns when they was trapped in the midst of slavery, had no clue when they would be let free. When they sung those hymns, they sung those hymnals in hope that they'd be free, but more particularly, that their generations to come would be free. That's what they wanted. That's what they wanted the most. So when you sing a song, and you just imagine those people who was here in the original slaves, settler, the original one, they know pretty much they weren't gonna never be let free. But when they sung those songs, they sung them for people like me. And when you think about it, we only 50 years removed from fighting for civil rights. And you know, just because they gave us the civil rights right away, you know they wasn't given to it and handed over and transitioned smoothly. So you probably had another decade of just arguing about what you're supposed to have been given as a right. Mm-hmm. So when you look at the timeline, it's a very small blip on the radar where we are today. We're only 50 years removed from a 400-some year pandemic, if you want to call it that. So I'm just here just to voice my opinion, voice my perspective, and hopefully that someone listening and someone in this group here can inspire someone that's viewing, and also push us to try to do more than talk. Let's be active.
Well, hopefully people get out of the conversations that we have today a sense of hope, a different perspective of their lives and in their future, and how to embrace doing something about it in a different way, in a kingdom way, in a godly way. I'm never going to get away from the godly way, because his way is the best way. Regardless to, you know, popular belief in our country, his way, it trumps every way. We're going to have to figure it out. But I think also getting out of this conversation that it's like your pastor said over here. He said it's not about us, but it is about us coming together. I really believe we can get something started right here. We can be a small seed, a small yeast in this world that's going to multiply and it's going to expand. And all we got to do is start small. And sometimes it just starts with us talking about it first. Now, hopefully, these conversations lead to something that you guys can talk about in your homes. We can talk about together. We don't have to get awkward, but it's going to be awkward. We don't have to get indifferent, but it's going to be indifferent. And so, in those times, I want you guys to be able to come to an agreement. And the agreement should be, hey, how are we going to make it equal? How are we going to become a human race? Not a human color. And when we stop being colorful, and we start being humans to each other again, this is going to change the system. And hopefully out of these conversations, we actually find a way that we all talk, not just a bunch of brothers talking, not just a bunch of black people talking, all white people talking, but all of us talking about how we're going to survive this, not just pandemics of disease, but pandemics of human conditions. We all have, we get mad, we get angry, we get sad, we get bitter at things, we get vengeful, we get vindictive, and we have opinions. And those opinions have to be changed to kingdom godly opinions about right. each other and about what right. this life is all about. So hopefully these conversations will bring us to a table that we all can talk at. And I hope that it brings hope to you guys. That's what I want to get out of it.
One second. I don't know. I mean, we have mics, so I'm assuming that everybody can still hear us. I don't know how long they can be, so I don't want to just pause them, but I don't think they can take long. City workers, they're doing what they got to do. I think they can't stop from doing their job. It just so happens to be just coincide right in the middle of us talking. So we're going to try to talk around instead of just waiting, because I don't know how long that's going to be. But just let us know. Can't hear us, we will. But as long as y'all don't say nothing, then I feel it's all good.
Well, we don't come to these kids. What I expect you to get from me today is a motivation to realize that tomorrow is going to be a change and things are going to be better. I come with solutions today. I hope that when you finish listening to me, you're like, I need to get in touch with that guy. I need to help that guy organize. You know what I'm saying? Because I like what he had to say. And I believe that this can be a way for us to move forward, not as black people, like my brother just said, or as white people, but as people, just people, okay? So I have a few solutions, and I really hope that I can motivate the masses to say, yes, I want to walk with him. I want to march with him. I want to get that done. Thank you.
We apologize for that noise. It's quieted down some. We're going to just try to talk a little louder through our mics until they leave instead of just pausing. So bear with us, y'all, and we're just going to speak out a little louder with your mics. So speak, project your voices a little bit. When they leave, you won't have to do that. So moving on around.
Today, I just want the viewers to get a better understanding of how to react to situations and not a violent or non-violent way, but just in a way that's logical and that will reflect us as a people and as a person. Because the rioting and all that, whether you may deem it necessary or unnecessary, it reflects you as a person. And you might be rioting just to riot and not even know the reason behind it or why other people motivated. So it's just everyone's motivation is different. And understanding the bigger picture is really the most important thing.
I want to put out that we got to go back to God. We have to go back to God. We have to go back to God. We have to allow God to heal us. Then we have to have changed behavior, because violence is not the answer. And to our communities, we gotta stop the gun violence. We gotta stop the drug activity. We gotta show that we care about ourselves, so that the world can see that we are somebody, because we are somebody. We matter. All humanity matter. So we have to make a stand, and a stand that goes, that may rough for our own fellas because we have to make changes. I've previously made changes, but it's worth it because it ignites the betterment that I'm building within myself. God gave us all the spirit of sound mind and of power. We shouldn't feel no ways of like, okay, I can't do this, I can't do that, too much going on. We gotta stand and really do it instead of talking. We gotta change. We gotta change for the generations under us.
Wonderful, wonderful points of view from each panelist. And I wanted to just go ahead and just, let's just jump into it. I've been noticing.
They said they can barely hear y'all.
Yeah, I seen it. We responded to them. That was a few people ago. We just gonna speak as loud as we can. Y'all make sure y'all on that side over there with the mics that y'all kind of try to hold them right, because when y'all hold them right, I can hear y'all good. So let's work on, we're gonna work through it. We'll pray that these people get on our head, don't mess up our whole show. But hopefully y'all can hear me. I'm gonna speak louder as best as I can. To me, I've noticed this invisible line that seems that law enforcement and these officers are standing behind. And it's the line that says that we're fearing for our lives or using excessive force for murder as it relates to the killings of black men. This seems to be, to me, this is just speculation, but and I know that it's not new. It's just getting recorded and documented a lot more. But it seems evident that either they have a full understanding that nothing's going to happen to them, or nothing is likely to happen to them when they commit these crimes in front of cameras, when people are unarmed and not even causing them any kind of resistance. When we notice this live on a camera, because they can't take the camera from you. That's your right, and I'll go over that in a few minutes. Like some of the rights, if people was able to catch somebody or record a police officer doing something like that. And listen, before we get deep into it's not a police badge. You know, we do enough to ourselves as well. But that just don't excuse them, though, because they are people that we hold to a higher standard. I'm not saying it's fair, and I'm not saying it's right, but when you take on that badge, it's an oath to protect and to serve.
That's right.
They seem like they're skipping those first main mantras right. That they stand for. And I know it's not all of it. It's not even half of it. It's not even a big percentage of it. You know, I got a homeboy, I got a lot of friends that are police officers, and I respect what they do to the utmost. I need them. We need them around. And so I wouldn't do no bashing, but I just like I told him, he was going back and forth with me all week about his take on it and us not trying to remind us not to be side swiped and not to be bamboozled with all this over-sensationalism of media as it relates to police department and the job they do. And I said I would make sure that I try to present a balanced argument. But I still have to be honest to speak about what's specifically going on. And I just wanted to see what you guys do. You guys feel like I feel when I say that there has to be some type of handshake or understanding or something. I mean, it's speculation. But what do you think would allow somebody to do what they're doing in front of cameras if they felt like they were going to get time for what they're doing? If you felt like they were going to really get time for what they're doing, do you feel that they would be doing this? Or what is, am I wrong for thinking that apparently it must be some kind of invisible line that they've been told that if it's on the line of being great, and it ain't just rarely great, and sometimes it's very black and white and clear that they're wrong, but when it's great that they have the right to use excessive force? I don't know. Am I alone? Am I thinking anybody can take that? Anybody can take that?
Well, I don't think that you're alone in your thinking. But I do believe that they have all, it's like this. And I've said this before, and I'm going to touch this subject just briefly. If I send my sons to your house to fight you, and then you come to my house to tell me what my sons have done, even though you may think that I'm being a responsible adult and I'm the authority who's going to deal with that situation, you don't know that I'm the reason that they came and assaulted you from the beginning. So when you go and sit in the courtroom, when you go and sit in any of these things, then you know what I'm saying? These are those people's foot soldiers. In the military, if you come and say that a group of soldiers was sent on a mission and they successfully attacked the community and run the insurgents out or run out the dissidents, whatever they wanted them to be, or dealt with them in the manner that they wanted it to be. You come back to the post and command and complain to the commander, he gonna look at you like, okay, take the report and realize that the mission was successful. So, you know, that's why I'm here today with solutions, because I feel like if we continue to react to the police officer, okay, then we're chasing our tail. We need to go after the system in place that allows him to feel that comfortable. We need all of the rules rewritten, okay?
Yes,
we need to put common sense court in place instead of just legal court, because legal court don't have no common sense. We have to, above all, we have to realize that the reason that this can happen to us is because it's clear. We have no unity, we have no pride, we have no discipline. You see what I'm saying? We'll eat from people who didn't feed us as children. We let people who didn't fix our hair before we knew we had hair do our hair. We let them control and sell us everything. Why is it that the black community is the Fortune 500 company for every nationality that newly arrived into America? Okay? We are the most international community you can face. You go into a poor, failing black community, you're going to find people from the Middle East running businesses. You're going to find people from Russia running businesses. You're going to find people from all walks of life running businesses in the black community. But then you go into the white community and there is none of that. Why is the standard that we hold? And until we realize that these people are going to continue to disrespect us as long as they can get our money without having to do anything. These people in your own community have stores and they won't even fix that sidewalk that the roots is making the sidewalk grow uneven, or sponsor a little league team. They cuss you out in a store and take your money until you get out. Who's going to respect the people like that?
That's right.
Who?
That's right.
But that's why I'm here with solutions. Okay? So, what I propose is my Louisiana Public School Reconstruction Act. Okay? Now, the Louisiana Public School Reconstruction Act goes like this. When a child gets to the eighth grade, they would pick two trades. Let's say your child wanted to be an electrician and a plumber. So when they get to the ninth grade, they would start to study those classes. In the 10th grade, they would go off-site to put the book knowledge into practical use. In the 11th grade, it would be a combination of book knowledge and off-site knowledge. Then, towards the end of the 11th grade year, they would take the state license examination. So when they pass that, you're graduating people independent of the government because they have the ability to experience the American dream. If your baby came out of high school a licensed electrician, they would not be thinking of joining up with the dope man. If your baby came out of high school knowing how to repair washers and dryers and lawnmowers,
Yes, sir. They
could experience the American dream just like they can come right out of high school and experience the American nightmare, which is the penitentiary system. We have to recognize that these people have put an exerted effort into making a system of public school to the penal system. And so if it's worth all that to them, it should be worth all that to us to fight to say, no, we're going to correct it. You see what I'm saying? We need to remove college courses for people who not going to college out of high school. Everybody not going to college from high school. We can make those electives. What I propose is we put economics in school. You understand me? We put anger management in school because our children need more tools to deal with their problems, more problem-solving tools besides just their fists and some bad words. You understand? And last but not least, we need to put those trades in that I was talking about earlier. I'm not going to hold up all the time because, you know, it's other guys on here want to talk, and I'll be back a little later. But I'm full of solutions because I've been looking at this ever since Rodney King. So I'm not upset about it. I'm not nothing. I understand that now we need to come up with a way to keep it from happening. We don't need to keep on doing. They rioted for Rodney King. That was 30 years ago. If rioting was going to work, we've been rioting for over 30 years. At some point, it would work. It does not work. What we have to do is we have to go at the rules and rewrite the rules.
That's a wonderful solution.
Yeah.
I'm glad he came with solution. He prepared. You know he was ready. But I know that some of you guys may have lost the original question, so I want to bring that back. And I want you guys to just kind of answer that specifically. I was pretty much saying, do you think that there is some kind of imaginary or invisible line or some wink of an eye or some private handshake that has gone on in the upper echelons of law enforcement that is giving these police officers the license to kill when it's at all questionable? It don't have to be even blatant, just any question. So I want you to answer that specifically, if anybody want to take that.
I can take that. In my city, first of all, like I said from the jump, it's gonna take us to do it in the community, because my city, the police bring in all the drugs. Okay. So when someone lose respect, it's like, okay, I got something on you, so I know you're not gonna do this or you're not gonna do that. So that's gonna give me the power over you. Okay. So to me, it's something funny. It's more so of dealt hands under the table. Dealt hands under the table. That's what's going on. And I'm not blind to it. And I'm not afraid to speak on it either. But it's going to take for us to really get together in the community and stand up against the police and the cricket police and let them know, look, we straight now. Ain't no more funny business. Then they got to respect us.
Anybody else
want to
shed any light on that? Go ahead, Kobe.
To answer your question, I think there is an invisible line that police officers understand that if we do this thing to these people, nothing's going to happen. And I think it all goes back to what Gil and he said. It starts in the community, because as a people, we devalue ourselves. So the system is going to devalue us as a people. A black life matters, but to them, it has no value. Right. So, I mean, if you kill someone we don't care about, hey, you're not going to get no time.
Right.
You're doing your job and through our laws. Right. So, I mean, it's, we have to stand up, because you can be rich, you can be poor, mm-hmm. you can be a regular man. But at the end of the day, when you get pulled over, you're just a black male.
That's right. That's
so, because none of this matters until we get them to understand that we do matter.
That's right.
That's
that
very
was
well
powerful,
put.
Very well
and
profound. Yes, sir.
I want to go briefly over a few statistics to kind of preface everything for the viewers that may be unaware as we go forward with the rest of the show. But in the United States of America, I don't know if many of you, some people really don't get to travel much, and they really do feel that we are more of the population than we really are. But really, we only make up 40-something million people in America out of 326 million. That's 14%. And you go to various sites, it might vary a percent or so, but that's pretty 14%. Much where we are. Of that 14%, though, 8% are female and 6% are black. Are male. That's it. We only make up 6%. Us black men here only make up 6% of that 326 million person population. So what I'm getting at when I say that, this is what's weird, though. You know, there's a such thing as disproportionate. But in the prison system, black males make up 56% of the male prison population. Now, if you only make up 6% of the entire population, if you was being fair, then we should be, that should be the same ratio in prison. Mm-hmm. But that's a big distinction. 56% of the male population are black men, and I want y'all to guess, my panel, any of you or all of you, what do you think the target age range is for these black men? So a range. So from what number, when what age to the next age? So give me an actual age range that you think they're targeting our black men.
17 to 25. 17 to 30. And you know, I heard you in the shop, yes. But I'm still seeing what I originally believe. Okay. I believe that it starts at the third grade. And they already have it well defined by the time you get to the 10th, 11th grade. Right. So they know exactly how they have shaped and molded you. And so, Ben, yes, and from all of the past information they have, they know exactly what conditions to put you in and keep you in and what the logical outcome will be because of doing this type of humiliation and degradation to so many people for so long that the facts now show what human behavior is, what will happen.
Well, I'm going to share what the statistics bear, and many of you will dead on. And again, you can take some of this with a grain of salt, because it depends on all the reporting. But we got to go by something. The actual age range is 17 to 35. You guess why? Because I can tell you why, but I want somebody to take a stab at it. Why? Why you think 17 to 35?
I think that age group is right at the beginning stages of maturing young males. Also, in that range is also where most fathers are fathering their young males.
Absolutely.
In between the 17 to 35. That's about a good 20 years, I would say, that you have to help your son mature.
Yes.
So if you take that kid out of that and put him in a system that he can't be matured by a real father, and also eliminate the fathers that are young enough to train up their child in the way he should go,
yes,
you got a
right
messed up home.
Yes. Right.
So you can't correct anything at home. It's just like National Geographic or Wildlife or something like that. They talk about the herds of elephants. If that bull elephant, that male elephant, the lead one, if he's gone and they have a young male elephant around and it's mating season, he's going to try to tear up everything in that whole herd because there's nobody to correct him. As soon as that bull comes back, he stops and puts himself in his place.
Mm-hmm.
But because there's nobody to groom him, the immaturity in that male causes him to run wild. I'm just be with all of them and try to get all my seed out and mess up everything. But I think in that range, 17 to 35, it's very key to know that there's fathers that are young enough to handle a young male, and the sons are pliable enough to learn from them.
Mm-hmm.
But when you have nobody to learn from, what do you go to? TV,
streets,
social media, streets. Your boys,
music.
You know, the quickest way to make money.
Music.
So, yeah.
And music got influence, too.
And they're influencing us. They influence us in a way that it's not realistic. We're influenced by the distractions of TV.
Yes.
The distractions of videos. The distractions of money that rappers don't have. The distractions of, this is the car I have, and you can have it too as long as you're doing what I'm doing.
Right. Yeah.
Put on this persona because it makes you look like you got stuff, but really ain't nothing earned. So a lot of the times, our young men are being taught by a system that's being controlled by the system we talking about right now.
Yes, sir.
So if I picked you because you're talented to be in front of the TV, to be on the TV so I can train your younger 17-year-olds how to be, they're going to be in the same situation under me.
That's right.
They're going to sign my contracts. They're going to be led around by what I want them to do. They're going to make me the money. And after I'm done with them, I'm going to throw them to the dogs. And that's real talk.
Right.
Real talk?
Real talk.
That's real talk.
I want to say something in that vein. And I appreciate you fellas because y'all pulling some topics out of me that I said I was going to stay away from. But this isn't divisive. This is actually unifying with the way we're talking about it, okay? So, you know, growing up, I had a father to raise me. And my friends, the majority of black males are being raised by their mother.
Right.
Okay? So, my perspective and the way I see things and the way I go about doing things is a lot of times different from my contemporaries. And, you know, if you are raised by a woman and you are a male, but you have no examples of what a male do,
right,
you're going to copy that woman. So if all you have is a mother, you have a woman's attitude. I hope that in the sound of my voice you hear this and you understand where I'm coming from. Not be insulted, but understand that, see, like, my mother would get on my father. He would give her the bill money or what have you, and he would go on about his way, sit in the living room or what have you, and his skin was thick, it was tough. He would still go to work and he would make that money, he would bring that money back home. You understand me? And because of those examples of how I seen that man always get up with nothing and come back with something, I had what it took to me to get out there and do it. when I was 15, 16 years old, I knew how to change the tire. I knew how to change the battery of the car. I knew how to change the alternator and the starter and all those type of things. I knew how to paint and trim and cut and do all those type of things because I had a man in my life showing me what men do. And then the most important thing was that man hugged my neck, kissed my cheek, and told me, job well done. So I received love from a man. You see what I'm saying? So it wasn't foreign for me to understand that men love on one another. Okay? Right. But when you don't have no examples of what a man do in the home, then you're going to be the one howling like the woman be howling at them children, getting that quick temper. You wonder why we hurl around and hurt each other. It's because, see, when a woman lose her cool real quick and she might hit, she ain't gonna cause that much destruction. But you, with a woman's attitude and that short fuse, man, you'll cause a whole lot of destruction, you know? And so many of our men have been blinded that they carry themselves with the disposition of a woman, you know? And last but not least, I have to say this. Any black male or female that's telling another black male or female through any venue, TV, radio, whatever, to pick up a gun and hurt another black male, to take drugs, to, if you see them doing that, they are what's wrong with us. Don't idolize those people. If the guy who you listening to, who's playing music on a music video, is telling you that he take drugs and so do drugs like him, no, he's a dope head. And the same way you recognize the dude on the corner is a dope head, recognize just because he on TV and some people that gave him some money and been wrote all over him and everything, he is a dope head. You understand me?
Yes, sir.
If he telling you that he gonna take his gun and go show somebody something, and that's a false definition of being a man. Black men, we are tillers of the land. We are loving people. Let me tell you something. I'm emotional. You're emotional too. Ain't nothing wrong with me. But you see, somebody can stimulate you the wrong way emotionally. You understand? And have you out here and got yourself in a lifetime worth of trouble before you get 2 days worth of common sense. So, you know, I digress because next time I get a chance to talk, I want to tell you more about my solutions.
Can I say something on that? This is why it's important to know that through all that what he just said, it was correct. But you got to have peace in God. You got to have understanding in God. You got to have strength in God to even try to pursue to be a father or even to be a community activist. You got to have a relationship with God because you got to have some patience. One day you're going to have to turn away from a fight just so that you can show that peace is being imparted. This is what's important. Getting back to God. And we got to enforce it in our homes because everything starts in our home. Ain't nothing going to work. It ain't worked before I came in this world. We got to enforce the word of God in the house so it can soften the hearts of those hearts of frozen ice. People are bruised and battered because of their family members. It's so much, and it's going to take God to do a supernatural cleansing and a supernatural healing just so that we can think in a normal perspective. God needs to be enforced back in schools. Prayer needs to be in schools. All that needs to be back. If that was to take place, I would feel more comfortable with saying the world can become a better place. But because we're a nation that has turned our backs to turn to God, we're doing so much wickedness out here. And we jumping up because of what a police issue is, which I don't agree with it. I don't like it either, but we got to look at what's deeper. Look at how we acting. Look at the sins we committing. How many of us really repenting? Is God satisfied with our actions? More problems going to occur. It's not going to get better. We can't make it better. God can.
That's awesome, awesome. That's real talk, man. That's real talk. I'm going to get specific about that 17 to 35-year-old range, why we are being systemically targeted to be taken away from our homes. First of all, when a man is in a household, whether he's a great provider by people's standards or not, but if he's there in any capacity, just in general, the odds show that that house is a little bit more successful. Just off just pure combining all the resources together. And, but for more than just that, the man helps his young son understand conflict resolution. When you don't have a man there, I'm not saying mothers can't do their best, but it get a certain age when you notice that sometimes even those family households where the dad no longer in the same house with the family anymore for various reasons, it get to a certain age that mamas usually concede and say, go ahead and stay with your dad.
12, 13.
Because they just realize that it's some things that they're going to face that I just am not equipped to give them.
That's right.
So the 17 and 35 year old range is all the things that Andre touched on. And Gil has some wonderful kind of solutions in between and some perspective on it. But it's also got a ton of aspects to why that target range is so vital. For one, it's just simple as ABC. For one, it's going to help depopulate our race. Do you know black American population has been the slowest growing population, and I don't know, about 50-something years. We have not grown that much. And you could say, why? Well, for one is, we getting arrested when we would normally be having children.
Okay.
By the time we get out of jail at 35 to 40, we may have a child, but the prime time for us to have had most of our kids was in that range. Then you have kids growing up the whole time frame, a whole adolescence without a father in the home. And then they have also systemic advantages to discredit a man or to not want the man in the house that we all know about, such as tax breaks and welfare recipients, Section 8 housing and all kind of low income type benefits for, you know, you can come over, but when these people get ready to come by, I want you, you need to be gone. But you're the father and head of the house though.
Right.
But it's not advantageous for you to be recognized as a living, active member of this household. Correct. Good term. What you got, man? Go ahead.
And I know a solution that can help that for that black man. We always looking at for solutions in a physical form, okay? We always trying to call somebody, right? If you just dig and get a relationship, God will bless you. God will send somebody your way and open up a door that gives you opportunity to get your own place. When I first moved here to AME, I was homeless. I stayed in the shed. I had open heart surgery. I got a mechanical valve, a pacemaker, and a defibrillator, right? Now I'm in a program. I'm in an apartment a year later. And my wife and I finna move in our house. Because I changed my life, okay? And I followed the instructions in that book. I'm not perfect. Right. I fail. But guess what? The desire in me keeps me going. And that's how I get by as a young black man in America, because of God.
Awesome, man.
So I'll piggyback off of that. So there's truly no excuse behind the decisions we make at a certain period of time in your life. Regardless if he had a father or not, there was a certain period of time when he had to make a choice. I'm gonna stop being homeless. I'm gonna stop being whatever, troublemaker, whatever the case may be. I'm gonna get my life together. Most of the time, we don't have anybody in our lives, so we're not even asking God to say, okay, God, I need you to fix this. I'm tired of this. I need you to fix it. We have to get to a point where we're tired of what we're being at, and we can't be the answer to it. Our entitlement, our anger, our poverty-stricken situations cannot be the answer. What the government tries to offer us as solutions cannot be.
It's not
the excuse we use to stay where we are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's too many testimonies. There's too many people that have gotten over the hump.
Yes,
and not using it as an excuse. And even in a black home, I'm gonna say in a black home, the man not being there is a big issue in that age bracket, 17-35, is a big issue because we don't get to see this man overcome. We don't get to see this man conquer. We don't get to see this man be victorious.
Yes.
We don't get to see my daddy say, you know what, I lost my job,
but I'm finna hustle and get something else. Right. We don't get to see, hey man, I know they was arguing in the room, but they got it straight.
Yeah. Right.
And they still loving on each other.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
And you know what? We don't get to see when daddy makes a mistake, how he recovers.
Yes. Right. Yes.
So a lot of the times I'm gonna say it like this, you know, all of us ain't privileged people to see
right.
that.
That's
but
right.
for the most part, it is a helping situation for a young man to see something. The nothing at all.
Right, right.
So like he was talking about statistics, and I love the numbers, the analysis that we have on statistics, and it actually helps us understand not just the system doing it, but us doing it to ourselves.
Yes,
so we can talk about systems. About, yeah, the system is already set up for it.
Right.
But do we allow it to happen by our actions? Ask yourself the question.
Yeah, that's right.
What
we
am I doing?
Ourselves.
Right. What am I doing
cool.
to make that system work?
Right.
What do I do in my house as a father to make that system work?
Right.
What do I do as a young black man to help that system work for them?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So anyway, you want to go ahead? Pat?
Yeah, go ahead. My take on the situation is that all of the situations that we're going through, I feel like that we're fighting the spiritual warfare every day in our life. Whether the father is there, whether the mother is there, or whether vice versa, as we going throughout this cycle of life, because it's a cycle. As we going throughout this cycle in life, the enemy is against us at all costs, especially when we proclaim that we have God that's a part of our life. So I got a scripture. Because you asked to get scriptures and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And it says in Ephesians the 6th chapter and the 10th verse, it says, "Finally, my brothers, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you will be able to withstand, to stand against the schemes of the devil.
That's
for
right.
our fight is not against
right.
flesh and blood,
yeah. yes, sir.
But against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness
yes,
in high places.
Yeah.
And against spiritual forces of wickedness in heavenly places."
That's right.
So that is causing for us to do something. It's causing for us to take action, and it's causing for us to have an action within ourselves, because it's letting us know right, period, point blank, we're not fighting against flesh and blood.
Yes, sir.
But we're fighting against principalities, rulers of darkness, and spiritual weaknesses in high places. How can we do that? We have to do like my brother Therese and everybody else been saying throughout the whole panel. We have to have God in our life.
That's right.
Amen.
Can I jump on
yeah,
that real quick?
Yes.
And with that, that's why we don't know that dude that tried to rob you. You didn't know that was a spirit. He was driven by an angry spirit because he was jealous of what you have. Instead, you should just, when you see him, ask him, do he need anything? Look out for him or something. We always resort to something that's way, way smaller than the biggest picture. The big picture is simple, love. If we love our brothers and sisters, that's what God tells us to do. That's what Jesus tell us to love in the Bible. If that's what happened, we got off track. If we would just love, a lot of this wouldn't even happen.
Right.
But guess what? Because we Adam descendants, right? Adam disobeyed God. We disobeying God. So guess what's happening? Wickedness. Wickedness is on the land. Wickedness is everywhere. And it's sad because we hurting ourselves. And then when the police hurt one of us, we go do something to the police. Not every police is racist. Not every black man is ignorant. What I'm saying is this. Love will fix it. And you can't love with the love that you thought you know about, the love that you was the love that brought you to the streets, the love that brought you to buying a jewelry and the shoes and the car. The love of God is what's gonna keep you and what's gonna get you to that place of, listen, okay, I wanna do better in life. You can't do it. You gotta, and the women who's single parents, my grandmama used to make me go to church. Go to send them kids to church. It's a man in the church.
Take
send him to church.
Take
and then, and if you do that, you have a better chance of him having a mentor, so he won't do nothing crazy in the streets. I done that. I was shot 3 times. I shot the dude back, went to prison, got cut from here to here. The dude brother was in the same dorm. All because I was pressured to go do something when I really didn't want to do it, but I ain't have no other option. We need to put an option in the community for these young kids, okay? So, because when my life broke down in front of me, if I didn't know Jesus, I wouldn't have had that option. I thank God for my mother. I thank God for my grandmother, because you know why? They gave me the option. They trained me the way I should go.
Let me piggyback off there just right quick. I want people to know that don't understand where we're coming from. The reason why you don't, because I don't want you to feel like you're outside of what we're saying. You're not. You're a confession away from understanding what he means by when he accepted Jesus and when he turned his life around, when he said he needed God in his life. It's always an opportunity for you to say, okay, well, what is that like? He's telling you his story in a parable. And he's saying, look, this is my story. This is my testimony. I'm a testament to what God has really done. So if you do it, if you at least try it, something is going to happen for you. I'm going to say that because I look at Kirk Franklin's life. And I know y'all know Kirk Franklin. Do all the music and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
This man's name was changed 3 times. He didn't have a father. It was changed 3 times. First name was Matthew. First time was Mathis. The second time, I don't know what. Then somebody took him in that was at a church, a woman. Last wow. name Franklin said, I'm going to take this little young boy in. And I'm going to raise him in the church.
Right.
And I'm going to raise him to be godly. And he ended up being one of the most popular artists
right.
in the world. Black
right.
man.
Right.
You can't tell me it don't change when you make a different decision.
Yes.
So for
that's
us
it.
In our homes, for men in our homes, I know this is about what's going on with George Floyd and all the stuff that's going on.
This all related. This a whole night.
But
this
is the deal. You don't change them. You change you.
Amen.
You change decisions you make, choices you make. Most of the time, the choice that we make is gonna actually put a road in front of us, a path in front of us
that's
right. Or wrong.
Right.
So in a situation like this, I want y'all to understand, if you don't understand what the Holy Spirit is, if you don't understand what we're talking about, we talk about Jesus and stuff like that, you have to at least inquire and ask a question. Sometimes it take you going to church just one time.
Yes.
Take you going to church and say, man, I
yes.
just want, let me go with my grandmother.
Yes.
I know my daddy ain't here, but I'm going to go with my grandmother this time. I'm going
right.
to see what it's like.
Yes.
There's a man there. There's somebody
right.
there that is going to that is assigned to your life.
Yes.
That if you give God a chance to do it, you'll live off kingdom principles.
That's right. That's
you don't
right.
have to live off this world's perspective.
Yes.
You'll live off the kingdom
yes.
perspective.
That's right.
You don't have to live off what a man can give you. And I ain't finna even put a color on it. Any man,
yes.
any money,
yes.
man or money, anything that has anything to do with somebody giving you something, you'll always have to depend on the kingdom of God.
Right.
And it always right. comes through for you. You'll never have to worry about, oh, am I, my bill's going to get paid. Never have to worry about, am
that's
I
right.
going to get sick from COVID-19?
That's right.
I ain't been sick one time.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Because I don't live off the principles and perspectives of the world.
Right.
You
me
don't
neither.
Have to do it.
Me neither.
You can understand what we're talking about. You can be engrafted into the
that's
kingdom
up.
Of God.
That's
you don't
real
have to
tough.
Worry
man.
About what a man is going to say. You're not going to have to worry about what social media is going to have to say. You're not going to have to worry about the news and what they have to bring, because it's all negative anyway. But
yes,
I'm going to tell you like this. As long as you stay in a position where
yes,
you're
up.
Looking at their perspective, you will always reap the consequences of their perspective.
That's right.
Join another team.
Right.
Become a part of another kingdom.
Right.
The kingdom of God.
Oh, right.
Hey, I gotta bring it in because we're going on that.
Yeah,
too long.
Yeah, okay.
But it's
yeah,
awesome, man. I ain't trying to stop you.
I ain't trying to go
there.
Yeah.
Hold on one second. What I wanted to say was, and I'm gonna read off a couple statistics just to reference it, because some people watching, they don't check this stats, they don't fact check. But what I am going to say is, a lot of black men, you know, and maybe even black women, young girls, they grow up with this wrong perception of what predestiny means. They really think that if it's already written and I'm predestined, then there's no need for me to do anything because it's already written for me. But this is where you got to have a little deeper understanding. This is a spiritual thing right here. It's written however you do it.
Hey.
If you change at 36 years old,
yeah,
it was written. If you don't change ever in your life, that was written. You cannot live your life saying that however it go is how it's gonna go. No, you, right, you have right, the right. capacity to change your life per day. Every time you wake up, you can change the ending chapter. It don't have to end how it was thought, how it started off. But we, so I'm, the only reason why I'm saying that is because I want people to get out of that mind frame of thinking that no matter what I do, it's yeah. it's destined already. No, it definitely matters what you do. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Gil. I see it.
So first, you talked about the time that they look to encapsulate, to entrap you and put you in the system. And Brother Andre went on to elaborate a little bit more, but he didn't bring it to that last point. He talked to you about those elephants and everything, but to see those, and when he was speaking metaphorically, and he was talking about the young man who was out of control, like the elephant was out of control, right? And then when the bull elephant came, how he got back in his place. The last word he didn't give you was, see, because the elephant had to get to maturity.
Yeah.
See, mm-hmm. they catch us before we get to maturity.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? And so I really just wanted to come back and touch that because that was so powerful what he had to say. You see, this is a powerful man right here because we were sitting here talking, and he said to me, he was talking to me about how to understand to treat each other like treating the neighbor like our flesh, right? And I realized that, you know what? Only a little boy stepped off that sidewalk to try and intervene in that police officer murdering that man. Only that little boy saw, and he was white, but only that little boy saw his father. Only that little boy saw his brother. Only that little boy saw his grandfather. You understand me? Right. All of those grown people could not be their brother's keeper. I'm right. guilty too.
Right.
Now, don't get me wrong. I have not had the opportunity. I have always said that if I saw the police assaulting someone, that I would not just stand idly by. You understand? And I pray to Jesus that he give me the strength that I would at least throw some water on the police officer and make him get off that person and chase me. You know what I'm saying? So I'm not trying to act like I'm King Kong. I want to say this now. A medical doctor knows more anatomy and physiology than any police officer out here on the street. And he knows when medicine can no longer do you no more good. But he cannot humanely put you down. And I'm talking about humanely. He could just let you go to sleep, right? But now the police officer can execute a perfectly healthy human being that medicine don't even need to help. Okay? We have to be able to look at that at face value and say, no. You know, now, last but not least, because I got to get this solution in. The federal government is responsible for the public school system. So we're asking the federal government to treat the state of Louisiana as an experiment. Okay, and for 10 years, we want you to fund the program so that our children can pick two trades. And then when they take the state license examination, the federal government will pay for that in the 11th and the 12th grade. If the kid does not pass in the 11th grade, they get another option in the 12th grade again to take it before they graduate. And also, they can come back up to 1 year after they have graduated to come back and still get their licensure. Because ultimately, what we're trying to do is develop an independent, stable people. Now, what we're offering the government is we want to look at how many people graduated with the license as an electrician or a roofer or what have you, and then turned into a life of crime. You're going to see the numbers are going to be way down because we only want to live like decent people. We're going to ask the federal government to see how many young people apply for food stamps and welfare who graduated knowing how to repair a washing machine and a dryer and a microwave and a stove and a television. How many of those people apply for food stamps and welfare? You're going to see none of those people apply for those things. What I'm offering is for us to be totally independent of the government and not have to beg at the government feet, not at the white man's feet, because the common white man don't make rules. You know what I'm saying? And when I said I have a public school reconstruction act for Louisiana, I didn't name no color, okay? Because we are all God's children, all right? And mothers, please look these trades up. See how much your babies could be making coming out of high school. And then come down to 117 East Oak Street at Mirage Barbershop and knock on my door. Say, where's Professor Gill at? And let me know, I want to march with you. Okay, because what we need to do is organize, okay, so that we can come together and boycott these schools until they give us what we need.
Hold on, y'all. Look, I'm gonna have to change gears, but I'm gonna let Kobe get his comment in first. But before I do that, after he does that. I'm just going to lay it out. I have to acknowledge some of these comments by the viewers because we told them that it would be an open expression. We can't get to all of them, but we're going to read a few of them. I am going to give my last statement regarding this particular topic that we're on, and then we're going to shift gears. But okay. Before we do that, I'm going to let Brother Kobe go ahead and jump in.
To piggyback on what everybody said, Brother Andre said what Gil said was his first thought on it was the age group was from third grade to 18, 11th grade. Third grade to 11th grade. Mm-hmm. The public school system is almost reflecting of the penal system.
Yes.
You eat at a certain time. Mm-hmm. You go outside for your hour. That can be reflective of the yard time.
Yes.
And I mean, they're grooming us to when we grow up out of school, we're already adjusted to the penal system.
Exactly.
And to piggyback onto what y'all said, from 18 to 34 is a very pivotal time in a man's life.
Yes.
If you're 18 without a father, you're almost a lost soul.
Yeah.
That's too old to be a juvenile.
Yeah.
But you're an adult now. So if you get in trouble, you don't have any guidance.
Yeah.
And to what Brother Andre said, without a man in the house, you can't, you don't understand what somebody sowing the fruits of their labor is.
Right.
Yeah. So you don't see the down and the up. You don't know anything.
Yeah.
So you're a lost soul looking at the dope man trying to get a bag, basically. So I mean,
wise man, right?
Without a father, you're lost. I mean, I don't see any youth in the church no more. And then when they do come down on the phone, so I mean, they don't understand God and what He said is love.
That's right.
If you're not in there, if you're not in the church, you don't understand God. So you're a lost soul going to jail.
Yeah.
And then once you get out, you're 35, your life over with, and you got a felony or any other misdemeanor. But if you're doing hard time, it's a felony. You can't vote and nothing.
What he said, what the people that got felons and everything, I came down here, Dollar General had hired me, but they fired me because my background check came.
And that's one of the things that's on the application.
With a deadly weapon, right? Guess what happened 2 weeks after that? God blessed me and my wife with our own cleaning service. Yeah. Today, we got our business license.
Amen.
Our shirts made.
Hey.
If you put God in it,
He
gonna see you through. I don't care how terrible your past is. Matter of fact, as worse you were in your past, the better you'll be on God's side.
That's awesome, man. I want to encapsulate that whole discussion real quick. Many of you hear the phrase black on black. We keep doing it to ourselves while we complain about these few times when it happens by the hands of a white man or officer when we do it to ourselves so much. And that is somewhat true, but it's definitely not a complete thought, because I want to clarify that. So when you hear the term black on black crime, and we kill more of each other, that is absolutely correct. But more white people kill more white people than any other race against white people as well. More Mexicans kill more Mexicans than any other race against Mexicans as well. And it has nothing to do with the race. It has to do with proximity to them. I live next door to you. You go to work at 5 in the morning. I've been watching your house. I'm going to rob you. Every once in a while, we'll go outside of our community to do it. But most of the crimes that we do to each other happen to people that we live by.
Yeah.
So, yes, that is true about the black-on-black crime. But they never tell you the rest of the story. It's every race against each other. It's always more than any other race against them. So I wanted to just throw that out there because many people don't know that. And before I move on from that, I want to acknowledge some of the comments that we've been getting, because they own it, man. We've been getting a lot of them, and we can't read them all, but I'm going to go up a little bit and just kind of pick a couple of them up, and we'll read them. And it sounds like most of them are comments, not many questions, so I'm going to catch it right here. It was earlier, Catrice, which is Charvin, that's our cousin, she said, I'm sorry, they need harsher punishment. She was referring to the police officers. We got so many more people have joined since then. Brent Butler, Donald Mason, Bun Bun, all these guys have joined since then. Let me read a couple more. We have Tyron been going in. Hold on. Let me see. She said, we need to see more men praising God in the house, outside the home, on the job, so that the young folks can see that men do love and praise God.
That's
and
right.
They need to see that.
That's
and they need to know there ain't nothing wrong with it. And it ain't
that's
weak.
Right.
And you're not strange.
And
weak.
I'm still a man.
That's right. Still a man. She also said they will praise the black community for the money they spend on Jordans, on polo clothing, but they won't bring to the TV that we do have black men and women praising God and raising their children properly. They do. Sometimes they do.
Wow.
Highlight the negative.
Wow.
They don't talk about the positive. I'm going to read two more. We're going to get back to them as best we can. It's wonderful commentary. Let me get back on here right quick, y'all. Bear with me. I want to, while that loads up, I'm going to go to a couple of statistics. I gotta give them that. Before I say that, I'll say Lionel Johnson said that's Tutu. He said, I'll be off one of these Mondays. Would be great if I can come online. Absolutely, man. Absolutely, Pastor. In 2015, it's just some statistics, so I didn't even want to go all the way to 20, because it's going to give you a very good understanding idea of where we headed at. It said police killed at least 104 unarmed black people. Now, I ain't saying they was innocent of no wrongdoing. I said they're unarmed. That means
you
should have
I
definitely will. That means you should have some other alternative method of subduing them without having to kill them. Now, I heard some officers tell me, and I don't know if this is factual, so if I have any officers out there that's watching this, if this is wrong, please come and say this is wrong. They said that they don't have shots to put you down. When they pull their gun,
they
shoot
and
kill.
Beat,
now, I don't know if that's true or not, because I always used to say,
yeah.
I mean, if you're trying to subdue him, if you shot him in his leg, he's still going to go down. You got him down, but maybe I just don't understand the way that's set up. So if somebody out there was watching, please clarify that for me. But listen, it said unarmed black people were killed by police at 5 times the rate of unarmed whites in 2015. What's wrong with that number? First of all, we already talked about we only make up 6% men, the black men in the world, in the country. 6%. If we only make up 6% of the population, that's 320 something million people in the United States of America. But we were killed unarmed now by police at 5 times the rate of white people. So first of all, white people make up 56 to 59% of the country. Sometimes you might catch some numbers that's a little bit lesser because the Hispanic demographic is expanding, it's growing. But that's somewhere in there, it's over 50. But for the first time coming up very soon, white people will finally be a minority, but don't take that the wrong way. Not a minority in the sense of minority, a minority in that the combined races and demographics of others have finally got close to being even. So that means they might be at 49%, but the other makeup has hit 51. Mm-hmm. It's getting closer. Not just black, but a combination of Asians, blacks, Hispanics. That's never been that way in the United States since the beginning of time. So what I'm saying, so they said nearly 1 in 3 black people were killed by police in 2015 were identified as unarmed. That means, so this leads me to something that one of my great friends, man, he's from here, man, I ain't gonna put his name out there, but I don't think he would mind. But he was saying, man, you gotta understand, bro. I'm not even saying, because he really truly, he has a different dynamic. He's a black man and he's a police officer, 20 something years. So he definitely don't, there's some aspects of what's going on with the riot and all that stuff, he definitely don't agree with, and I don't either. But he also has some different takes on the police side that I don't necessarily agree with, but I wanted to be fair and express it. He said, do you realize that sometimes race don't even exist in these killings and these murders? Sometimes it's strictly just incompetent, poorly trained police officers. How many of you guys, do you agree that that could be some of the reason? Because I'm gonna tell you why.
I know another reason.
Go ahead.
I think when they become police officers, they should do stress tests. They should see how much they can take, because most of them police officers be afraid.
Right.
When they see us, this is where I want to get on to on our side. The reason why a lot of this go on, because we don't have no type of happiness or no love in us, right?
Right.
So we mad, we angry, we got attitude, we do. Your attitude is where they looking at your attitude. We got to change from the inside out, and that will help us too.
Well, there's a lot of psychological damage on our side that police training will not cover. And it does go way back
to slavery.
And it also goes to how we are in our families, how we even deal with our own psychological damage from our own families messing with us. That's from molestation and all kind of craziness.
Yeah.
So you deal with us on the street and you come at us as a police officer and my frame of mind is not together.
Right.
And we might want to say we not, but we got mental issues sometimes.
That's right. That's right.
And so when you don't know how to deal with that, you're not trained to deal with that, and you come in and you're afraid and you got a gun.
Right.
It's just not the right storm.
No.
You know, so yeah, they to your statement about being under trained or poorly trained, I think sometimes it is to that point, where especially when you got unarmed people. I'm not gonna go for somebody being shot and they didn't have anything that made you feel threatened.
Right.
And you can't say my size makes you feel threatened. You can't say my skin color makes you feel threatened. You can't say, oh, he fits a description of somebody that told us about something that was going on around the corner, so now I feel threatened. None of that makes sense when he's unarmed and he's dying on the ground. So, you know, I don't know if that answers.
Well, it does. But before we answer, I'm gonna help y'all so y'all can stay on track with it.
Yeah.
When y'all answer this question, answer just this question.
Okay.
Specifically, I'm gonna rephrase the question again. Okay. And no, that was you was right. Ain't nothing wrong with expounding. But I want to make sure we don't jump off into solution stuff.
Because it's so much on these sides, man.
So when I'm going to ask this question again, and we had a question by Tyler, she said, next time put a few more women on the panel. I would have loved some. I put it out there, but we do have one here, and I'm going to get her input on this question here, too. I wanted them to come, because believe it or not, these young men that's been killed, these are y'all sons. These are y'all brothers. These are y'all nephews. So I wanted y'all to be on anyway. But it just so happened I didn't get much volunteerism from the women's sector. But next time, please feel free, man. This ain't going to be no subject that's going away no time soon.
Right.
So let me pass this all the way around, and I want you to just straight answer this question only.
Okay.
Are we dealing with pure, unadulterated racism or incompetent, poorly trained police officers or a combination of both? I'm going to start with my Aunt Aura, and we're going to come all the way around the table.
Yeah, ain't no fair,
so if you can, I don't know if you can turn it to face her or not. If you can't, but at least speak loud as you can, because she don't have a mic. But are we dealing with pure unadulterated racism or incompetent, poorly trained police officers or a combination of both? And everybody answered that question specifically. Go ahead on.
I think it's both.
It's both?
It's both, because a test that police, I don't really know what all they really go through.
Right.
But how can you test somebody in a situation that you never even been through yet?
Right.
You know
what
I'm saying?
You can't practice that.
How can you practice that?
Right.
There's no possible way that could be done.
Right.
No possible way. So I think it's both.
All right. That's good. Good. When we get to the end, I won't answer on that, because I'll wrap that up with some information that I have about that. So, passing it around, my brother Tavares, he's been on. He hadn't had a chance to say nothing yet, but I want him to answer that question. Do you feel that we're dealing with pure, unadulterated racism or incompetent, poorly trained police officers or a combination of both?
Me personally, I think they're already racist before they even get the badge.
My opinion.
So, really, that badge just give them a little bit more confidence.
I hear you.
So, they know they can get away with it. Look, they know we divided, so they can do what they want to and get away with it. All the police is a game.
Yeah.
Same thing, just like the streets, you know, they got a no snitch policy.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It's a combination of both, that's what you feel?
Yeah, they are, the hate already there.
Right.
Yeah, they can't stand us.
I got you.
They want to be us.
Right.
They know we the chosen race.
Yeah.
Long as we got to ask somebody else about our self-esteem. We gotta quit asking them for help.
Right.
Gotta believe in ourselves.
That's true, man.
You are somebody.
That's true.
You need somebody else to tell you somebody.
Yeah, that's true.
Yes. So where your confidence at?
That's true, man.
Leave it at that, man.
Great. Brother Tarek, same question.
Mm-hmm.
Is it both. A combination?
It's excuse both.
Me. It's both?
It's both.
Okay.
But I want to say
you
something.
You can say something about it. Why you think that or whatever.
First of all, no, I'm not gonna do that. Okay, this is what I'm gonna say. If I may be, I'm not overly thinking, but sometimes I do. But if perhaps somehow that the hearts can get softened through the police station, through the school systems, maybe the balance of the emotions of man could be balanced out in a more way, so that okay, I'm angry today, but I got enough love in me to know that just because I'm angry don't mean that I have to be rude to them. And I'm gonna tell you something, and it hurts me when I see young black men, white men too, no, it's really black,
right.
Because when they get pulled over, like I want to be better,
every day I want to be better, and I want everybody to be better. But it's like we always want to show off, like we got to be mad, we got to be angry. In the streets, I just came from the streets. The streets is the world. The world have its own system. It speaks on it in the Bible. That's why we don't supposed to be of the world. We in here, but we don't supposed to think that way. We don't supposed to react certain ways. But anyway, the streets, the only way you can get reputation or feel confident in yourself is shooting or killing or fighting or selling more dope than your partner or whatever the case is in the area. It's a lose-lose situation. Yeah. It's not fair. And what they doing, the police see that. That's why they bring it to the streets. And we standing up for people, but we falling down for senseless habits that's killing our race ahead of time before we even give them a chance because of drugs. All right, so if we just really know, it ain't even really what you just said. It's just spirits.
Moving on to COVID. We're dealing with pure unadulterated incompetence, racism, or a combination of both?
I believe it's a combination of both, because in all professions, you can have someone who's poorly trained in barbers, cooks, correct, teachers. Mm-hmm. I mean, in any aspect and walk of life, you can be poorly trained. But it's also, like he said, you know, if Gil's a police officer, he gets trained in Tyson Park.
Right.
But when he's on duty, he got a police Butlertown and Hines Quarters. So he's not ready to face what he was trained. He's in a whole different environment.
Right.
So how can you be from an all-white area and police an all-black area? You're going to react a totally different way. So basically, if I'm a police officer, I'm looking at Horace one way because I know Horace. Horace is my color.
Right.
But if I'm someone who doesn't know Horace, he's just a black man.
Right.
I have to... Compared to a white man, I have to come at this situation a totally different way because I'm scared. That's why it doesn't make sense. Why police an area you're not used to, a police people that's not your own people?
As I pass that around, I have to jump in there right there because I know that many times I always had an issue with the fact that, and I get a lot of this from my friend that's a police officer, but it makes sense too. He said a lot of these guys never been around just black folks in general, you know, on a grand scale. When I went to school, it was mixed, but it's kind of changing now. A lot of schools are getting back segregated again, and whether it's purposeful or not, it's happening. So body language, they don't recognize that. So I'm going to give you an example of what I mean by body language. I was working for Walgreens, and I was a manager on Government Street. They had a black guy in there in the line with dreads and smell of marijuana, but he's talking with that lingo and that street slang that we talk with, but I'm from the hood, so it didn't do nothing to me. He just was talking loud. He ain't nothing, non-threatening to me. Yeah, you know, he's like, you know, but he having fun with the person at the cash register because he know it. I had an assistant manager next to me who asked me, like, you think we gotta have to do something? Take that, apply that to what you just said. A lot of them never been around you in that manner. They assume that they need to be aggressive with you. Many of them, I heard this phrase a long time ago, and I believe there's some truth to it. They were either bullies or they got bullied, one way or the other in school. And when they take on that badge, and it's not all, man, please remember, we don't operate under absolutes. It's not all, it's not never, it's not always. But in these particular cases, I'm believing this has something to do with it. So I just wanted to share that while he was on it, because it fits what I was, some thoughts that I had already. So back to the original question, do you think that this is pure unadulterated racism, incompetent police training, or a combination of both, Brother Gill?
All right.
Let's try to stay on.
I'm on. Okay. And what I honestly feel is the police officer has been trained and he is the professional.
Huh.
Like the doctor has been trained and he's the professional. When you go to him, you don't know that he don't know how to do this surgery,
right,
that he's sitting in here talking to you, but that doctor will suffer them consequences if he go in there and perform surgery on you and reset your bowels or leave his instrumentation inside of you. Now, if you can clearly understand that this professional, and you were the layman, is fully at fault for anything they do to violate the oath of their profession, then it should not be a stretch for you to understand that it does not matter if it was poor training, or what was the other thing to select from?
Already made up, right?
Or racism. Right. It does not matter, because Incompetence breeds incompetence. And if you are a professional and you have taken an oath, I've sworn two oaths in my life. First to the Army and then as a respiratory therapist. I violated now one of them, okay? Because as a man, your word is your bond. So I'm not gonna give them any place to run and hide and say the lack of training caused him to be inhumane to another man. Mm-hmm. And I'm not gonna give them any scapegoat to be able to say, well, maybe we should do this or we should do that. Because if you are a human being, a real human being, you don't want to kill another human being. That's not a natural motivation. Now, you know, so I answered that one, and I just want to offer this as part of my Reconstruction Act as well. Now,
not right here. Okay. Not right here. I promise you.
Because I sure wanted to say something.
I'm going to let you get that in. Okay. I promise you. But I want, that's why I make
okay,
that.
Okay, so just acknowledge finish you. With this thing.
All right.
All right. The majority is the person who make the rules, not the popular number. The majority is he who make the rules. And I'll touch that
little bit. All right. Did you answer that question?
No,
okay, well, you answer that question, Andre. Are we dealing with pure, unadulterated racism, incompetent, poorly trained police officers, or a combination of both?
I can't speak to law enforcement or judicial system of how they train, because I don't really know how they train. I know that when it comes to cultural differences, whites don't grow up like us. We don't grow up like them. So body language, Ebonics, how we talk, the way we express, is probably taken a different way. So what we feel comfortable, they don't. So they can take that to the job. Regardless of how they've been trained, they're still a person, they're still a human being. They have human tendency. So when they get to the job, they're going to respond the way they naturally respond as a human being, as a default. So in training, you're not going to come up with, you know what, I grew up like that, so I kind of understand. I ain't going to overreact on this. You're only going to react to what you've been in and what you've been trained to do. So I think whatever training they're giving them, they need some background, some history on how things are, like some cultural history. Yeah, it's both. Racism. I actually looked up the suffix of ism on the way here, and it says a distinctive practice, a system or philosophy, typically a political ideology or an artistic movement of all isms. Fascism being one of the main ones, which is a form of authoritarian ultra-nationalism characterized by dictatorial power. Mm-hmm. So When you think about isms, it's a mentality. I taught you that. I showed you how to be like that. So anytime when it comes to racism and you talk about different cultures, they don't know how to come out of the ism they've been taught when they're in the job they're in. That's the ism they've been taught. That's the mentality. That's a practice. It's a practice. And on top of that, it becomes a spirit. And if you feed it, it becomes a dragon. You can't keep feeding the snake and don't expect it to grow up and bite your head off. So the whole point is that when you get to a point where you get isms involved in your everyday jobs, your vocations, and in your training, those isms start to come out more than likely than not because you don't know any better.
That's right.
So, yeah, so let's think about what we were talking about. I don't get back to what you said, so I'm going to move on. Think about what we were talking about earlier when we were talking about teaching our kids at home. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing on the other side of the spectrum.
Right.
Teach your kids that there is no isms.
Yes, sir.
Teach your kids that there is no separation in human being, in the human race.
Yes, sir.
There is no separation. The chosen ones are the ones who choose God. It's not the God chose this particular
brother. Yes.
Hallelujah. If you're chosen, it's because you chose him.
And following him.
And you follow him. And that's how he identifies us by his spirit. So if your spirit is racism, he can't identify with you.
That's right.
So you got to get rid of the isms. You got to get rid of the mentalities, the practices.
They go both ways. That's for blacks too.
Because you end up falling into the same traps in your home, your kids that they're looking at you like that, son. You're going to be like this. And when you get out there, you better watch them. But the whole thing is, and we all get to, I've been guilty of it too.
for the most part, we have to stop that particular thing, that ism, that racism thing.
Right.
Also, yeah, it's poor training, because I think the training has to include some type of cultural learnings and some history.
Yeah.
Can I please touch that? Hold on. If he do, I gotta touch something too, because I really want to say it's really important, though. It's very important, though. I'm enjoying all that, but I'm telling you, I gotta let Pastor touch on that. Is it? Are we dealing with pure unadulterated racism? I tell you what, my brother, right there said just what I'm finna say.
You know,
it's not.
When he said the ism thing, man, when you're dealing with that, you are motivated by something or something. Mm-hmm. You know,
they're going to go out in the
voice. And the thing about it is that when you have that spirit, because it's a spirit attachment.
Yes. Yep.
You know, and when you have that spiritual attachment upon you, then it makes you do unruly things.
That's right.
But the thing about it is, when you have the Spirit of God upon you, He's gonna make you do the things that which are right.
That's right.
That's all I got to
say. Can I say one thing?
I'm gonna let you say one thing. Keep it short. All right. Give say one thing.
Just what he said. Like when we go places, we already know what they thinking.
Right.
Okay. This is the time where we should do some self-discipline. Let's not act that much crazy. Yeah. You know, it's mean, because if you got the Spirit of God in you, then you're gonna want peace, right?
Right.
So you make adjustments. Let's not be so. Wow, wait till we get home with you. Like,
I'm gonna tell you like this here, man. Okay, anybody who know me, and I done got back on Facebook, so all of my friends and everybody from the past, young people, I done helped y'all all see me. Everybody who know me know Gil don't have most of the sandwiches that go in the picnic basket. Now, I have those sandwiches. It's just that I had to take the sandwiches out the picnic basket. You understand me? Because I have two sons that's blacker than night when you turn off the light. Mm-hmm. And these two young men aspired to the greatest of heights. And nobody had told them that because they were so dark and because how they were born, that they had limitations on whatever. And it made me go into a crazy sense of knowing that I had to be prepared to kill, maim, hurt, do whatever so that I could protect my seed. Mm-hmm. And so I was listening to my brother when he was speaking, you know what I'm saying? And yes, we cannot be teaching these isms because Jesus don't want us teaching no isms. You understand? That was bad on my part, because by me being weak and relying on my understanding instead of turning it over to him, I would have been able to show my boys, and I hope y'all watching, so that you can get this guidance right here. You understand? So you don't teach these young people to go out here and be fearful, or go out here and be worried about what's going to happen. I don't worry about nothing happening to me no more, because I have Jesus. And because I have Jesus, I walk with a confidence of knowing that you can't see me, nor can you touch me.
Yes,
you understand? And I just want to leave you with that. You often hear me say, for them that believe, everything that happened worked for the good.
I had a little exercise that I want to do with y'all, and I didn't give you any heads up because I wanted it to be authentic and raw emotion. But before I do that, I decided to do a "Where Are They Now" segment. And the "Where Are They Now" is, where are these police officers now after some of these high profile murders that have taken place? And I felt that would be an interesting piece, because I went into this saying, do they have this unwritten or imaginary line that lets them know that they're gonna be okay in the event that it's kind of gray? It's not really gray, but we can say it's gray in court, because it's hard for me to prove, fear for my life,
exactly,
and prosecute that.
Exactly.
So when I say Freddie Gray, I want y'all to just say Freddie Gray.
Freddie Gray.
So hold on, I'm gonna say it. That's how we're gonna do this for a second. Freddie Gray.
Freddie Gray.
Freddie Gray, 25. Six Baltimore police officers face charges ranging from misconduct to second degree murder in the April 2015 death of Freddie Gray. Gray died when his neck was broken in the back of a police transport van. He had been restrained with handcuffs and leg irons, but not a seatbelt. The death set off several days of rioting in Baltimore. The involuntary manslaughter trial of the first of those charged, Officer William Porter, ended in December in a hung jury. A judge acquitted two other officers in bench trials. The city of Baltimore paid Gray's family $6.4 million as a settlement for civil claim. So they were rewarded civilly. Don't bring back his life, but you see the officers got off. Y'all ready to move to the next one? We ain't gonna do just a few. I ain't gonna do many. Natasha McKenna, 37. McKenna died after being shot four times with a stun gun while her hands were cuffed her leg shackled. McKenna, who suffered from mental illness, and you're going to find that's a thing too, a lot of these people suffer with mental illnesses. She was in custody in the Fairfax County, Virginia jail on February 3rd, 2015, when a deputy used a stun gun on her. She died February 8th. They didn't say what happened to those officers in Nelson, so we're going to go to the next. Walter Scott.
Walter
Scott, 50. Michael Slager faces up to 30 years in prison if convicted of murder in the shooting death of Scott. Say, if convicted, who was running away on foot from a traffic stop in North Charleston, South Carolina. In April 2015, Scott was unarmed. Again, the shooting was captured on cell phone video by a passerby. Slager fired 8 times at Scott before he was killed, reigniting the debate over how blacks are treated by law enforcement. Slager, 34, was fired by the North Charleston Police Department and stands trial in October of that year. Previously held in solitary confinement, he has been free since January when he was released on $500,000 bail and put under house arrest. Last fall, North Charleston approved a $6.5 million civil settlement with Scott's family. Again, they paid the family. They didn't really dive into the final conclusion of the officer, but you kind of see where they headed with it. These last few I'm going to read, and then we're going to wrap that little segment up because I just wanted to be fair. Some of them, he's got very few arrests. If I read them all, we'd be here a long time, and you'll see how unbalanced it is. But I'm going to read these last few, and we're going to move on to the exercise. Michael Brown, Jr.
Michael Brown, Jr.,
18. Brown, a black teenager, was gunned down by a white police officer in Ferguson, Missouri, after stealing cigarillos from a convenience store. The shooting resulted in weeks of riots and protests in Ferguson and around the country while drawing attention to the relationship between African-American law enforcement in the United States. On August 9, 2014, Officer Darren Wilson responded to a reported robbery and encountered Brown and his friend Dorian Johnson walking down the middle of the road. Wilson blocked the two with his police car, after which a struggle ensued through the window. Wilson fired his gun and followed Brown after he fled. When Brown stopped to face the officer, Wilson fired several shots at his front, killing him. St. Louis County Prosecutors Robert McCullough announced November 24, 2014, that a grand jury had decided not to indict Wilson, and the Department of Justice cleared Wilson of civil rights violations in March of 2015. Officials found evidence that Wilson shot Brown in self-defense. So that we're going to two more. Ezell Ford, 25. A 25-year-old black man was shot after two Los Angeles Police Department officers stopped him on the sidewalk in South Los Angeles. The shooting came only days after the fatal shooting of Michael Brown in Ferguson and set off a series of protests throughout L.A. County. On August 11, 2014, two gang unit officers conducted an investigative stop after seeing Ford on 65th Street. Police say that when the officials got out of their vehicle and walked toward Ford, he tried to attack the lead officer. After a struggle, the lead officer's partner shot Ford, who later died at a hospital. Community members questioned the police account, saying Ford was mentally ill and was complying with officers before he was shot. In June of 2015, the LA Police Commission faulted officers Charlton Wampler and his partner, Antonio Villegas, for how they approached Ford in the moments that led to the shooting. So they did fault him in this. This is my last one. Eric Garner, 43. Garner died July 17, 2014, after a police officer on Staten Island, New York, placed him in an illegal chokehold during an encounter on the sidewalk where police said Garner was selling illegal cigarettes. A bystander shot video showing Garner's final moments and quickly fueled major protests and demands that the officers involved face criminal charges. City's medical examiner ruled Garner's death a homicide because of the compression of his neck and chest. Two officers faced an internal investigation in connection with Garner's death. The one who applied the chokehold was put on modified duty, meaning he was stripped of his gun and badge, but not arrested. While a police sergeant was stripped of her gun and badge and charged internally with failure to supervise. Most came with that. Neither has been charged with a crime, and police say Garner's poor health and his refusal to cooperate with officers contributed to his death. Police Commissioner William Bratt ordered a review of police training techniques in the wake of Garner's death. I ended with that one because I could have kept going, but it's a similarity to what's going on right now when they're trying to come out with the autopsy about George Floyd, about his underlying health condition. I'm going to give you guys a second look. Expound on that, because I don't know if it's going to stand, but I know you guys have seen the autopsy reports trying to switch around or take some of the steam away from the quote-unquote suffocation that he suffered at the knees of the officer by saying that he had underlying health conditions. So in my mind, where I take that is, I might have had diabetes, but you still choked me. I didn't die today of the diabetes. Maybe eventually I would have, but today you choked me. That's why I died. That's the train of thought I wanted to share when you're going toward, when you speak on this, when they try to say about these underlying conditions, when you clearly see that whatever his underlying health conditions could have been, we know to that day, though, he died because of the knee in his neck. So I'm going to give you guys a second to expound on that. And if one or two of you want to take it up, you want to go around, I don't mind. And then I'm going to get to the exercise. So anybody can take that.
In, back to the invisible line. If I can cooperate with you and say, okay, what we're going to do is we're going to make this medical, so at least you can't take the brunt of it. If that's in the system, then we have a problem, because I don't care if I had, I don't care if I was having a heart attack. They don't give you no reason to put your foot on my neck and choke me out to the point of I can't breathe, to the point of I'm gone now. So to me, I think, you know, all that's irrelevant. I think it's a part of what they're doing as a system, because they know these things are going to happen if they go out there as police officers and end up probably killing somebody. I don't agree with the fact that we can't see justice served. I said this to a friend of mine yesterday. What if you take one person that got authority and say, if I see you on screen, if I see you get recorded, and I know you took somebody's life unjustly, or, you know, without probable cause, you will give your life for that person. If the police knew that that was in some type of writing when it came to their job, you would not see that happen. I promise you. It takes one person in authority to do it. All you got to do is say, hey, this is in writing. This is your job now. If there's no reason to kill, if you're not threatened, there's no gun, and he ends up dead because on your watch, by your hands, you got to give yours. That means if that's life in prison, whatever the case may be, because it was uncalled for on your watch in this justice system. So if I was to correct it, if I was to bring justice to it, I would have to say, hey, consequences on both sides of this. So policemen, choose what you're going to do, because if you don't choose wisely, you will suffer the consequences for it. That's how it should be, I think.
Right.
But it's just too many instances where nobody is being prosecuted, or when they do get prosecuted, it comes out with all these other stipulations that were involved to make them feel like they free of it.
Right.
Anyway.
I'm going to give it to Tavares, then I'm going to bring it back to Pastor Wardell.
That fall back to the prosecutor. The prosecutor have more pull than the judge. Judge just go off what the prosecutor said.
Mm-hmm.
The prosecutor might stay in the same neighborhood as the same police officer.
Right.
He got to get back in there next year.
Right.
So he's not going to go against that dude.
Yeah.
He's just going to roll with him.
Right.
But you got to know who to go at.
But it's got to come from way higher than that.
You got to be real high, man.
You got to be way
high. Because I think it's real high that got him doing it now.
Yeah.
Because I know that them
officers, just a distraction.
Right, them officers would not want to put their life on the line and give up the opportunity to raise their families if they knew that they was going to be faced after they did an internal investigation where somebody that can judge whether they was trained properly or not me, but somebody who knows police work and what they're supposed to know. And when it's deemed that they was acting and exhibited excessive force and it resulted in the death of someone, if they knew that life in prison came behind that, you would find other alternative methods, because I thought the body cams was going to help prevent this. Yeah. I thought the cameras in general helped prevent this, but
they
seem to have something else going on, because they're not.
I know what the problem is. I feel like I do.
Go ahead. Respond.
It's the fact that every time something happened, what we do?
Protest.
We protest. We seek revenge, right?
Yeah, right.
The Bible clearly tells us, don't do that. The wicked will get that reward. They together, that's their group. So they gonna be pumped up off of what we done.
Right.
Somebody gotta just say, you know what, forget it. Somebody gotta come down.
Right.
That's what the Bible teaches, peace and humility and humbleness. We ain't got that.
Right.
What if Martin Luther King would have said that?
You're right.
Let's
forget about it.
That's right. I'm gonna get it to Pastor Wardell.
Thing about it is, they say the autopsy says something about
underlying health issue that causes death. I mean, the thing about that is, I can have an underlying health issue, and I control that underlying health issue, and I can live on to face, you know, years and years to come.
Right.
But if somebody have they knee in my neck,
right,
I'm gonna die from that because I'm gonna suffer from that issue that is going on within the issues and everything because like I said, an underlying death could be controlled. But, I mean, an underlying mental issue could be controlled, but somebody putting their knee in my neck can't.
That's right. At this time, I'm going to get to my exercise.
Okay.
And then after the exercise,
say something on that before you
go. Go ahead.
All right. I just wanted to say real quick that in cases where the medical examiner has ruled in our favor and called the death a homicide, because that wasn't what the police wanted to hear, mm-hmm, we still didn't get no justice. So I don't I don't really think that it's a matter of relevance as to how the medical examiner decide the death was caused by, because we've had it to happen both ways and we still get the same result. So I just don't want to sell us
we seeking justice from the wrong people.
If the medical examiner said this was cold-blooded murder and just those words right there, that would cause a change. I'm still sticking with my original premise that we have to rewrite the whole thing.
At this time I'm going to acknowledge some of the viewers and some of the comments. Like I said before, we wanted to have them included. Tyler said that he didn't have COVID-19 when he was on that ground. That's right. He said he didn't have a cold when that police officer Nikki was on his neck. He wasn't sick then, so now all of a sudden he died of complications from COVID. Lies. And that's absolutely what I was saying. You can say you have underlying health conditions, but it was a direct action that caused the death.
That's right.
We're going to move on to this exercise, and this exercise is called the first four words that come to mind when I say these words or phrases. And I'm going to go all the way around with it, and this shouldn't be long because it's four words. And you may need to expound just a tad, and that's fine, and it's cool. And you may say some of the same words by the time it gets to the eighth person because there's so many of us. But I'm going to throw out a name, a word, or phrase, and I want you to give me the first four words that come to your mind. And I didn't want y'all to practice on it and try to have it set up. I want the emotion from it. So I'm going to start with my Aunt Aura, and we're going to come around. So when I say this name, some of y'all that's at the end going to get a chance to think a little bit, but y'all probably going to get some of the words taken too, so you're going to have to be on it. Young black boy.
Jacob, my son.
All right.
Jacob, both my sons, my nephew, just
general. All right. Tavares, young black boy.
Son, the future. Leaders.
Mm-hmm.
Role models.
The dead. Brother Terrell, young black boy.
Hurt, pain, honest, struggle. Mm.
Brother Kobe, young black boy.
Could be anybody.
Brother Gill, young black boy.
Good luck.
No brother mine, man.
That's real. Brother Andre, young black boy.
Innocence.
Mm-hmm. That's what I would say.
Learning. Misunderstood.
For me, see if I think of this, undervalued, misguided, lost, my pride. Brother Dyson, young black boy.
Misunderstood, undervalued, fear, lost.
Awesome. All right, I'm gonna swing it around this way this time. I'm gonna start it off again. Privilege.
Need a much.
That's it. Privilege for me. White people. not me. Republicans. The upper class. Andre, privilege.
The wealthy. I would say whites. Good suburbs, good communities, good, I don't know how to put that word, I'm gonna put it in words, but privileged.
Living conditions, that would probably
be living conditions. Private schools. Mm.
Brother Gill, privilege.
White folks above the law.
Brother Kobe, privilege.
I'm not gonna say white, because not all white people.
That's right.
You know,
whatever comes to mind.
Money, mm-hmm. Freedom, no worrying. Mm-hmm.
That's good. Brother Therese, privileged.
Salvation.
Where your mic at?
Salvation. Joy. Hope. Happiness.
Right. Brother Tavares, privilege.
Well, I just had it. It just went away.
That's all right. Give me one or two.
Power.
Mm-hmm.
Well. All I got, man.
And aura, when you hear privilege, what four words come to mind?
God's people.
Thank you. Because we free.
Awesome.
We are really free.
That's right.
I can't believe
the only way we not if we get tangled in the system of the world.
You don't believe you free.
The whole idea is
That's right.
Look, can I say one thing? I was having open heart surgery August last year, okay? I was in the bed preaching. I had tubes coming out of my stomach. I had wires coming out of my neck, right? My ejection fraction like 15%. But I was happy. You know why I was so happy? Because I met God.
Hey.
Awesome. I was happy.
Hey. Hallelujah.
Awesome.
Hallelujah.
That's privy.
I'm going to bring it back around again.
Don't need nothing.
I'm going to start at Gil. And I'm going to go back this way. That way everybody getting a different time. They getting less time to think. So I thought it was going to come back to you at the end. But I'm going to start right here with Gil. Black woman.
Queen.
That's it?
The giver of all life.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody who's in a wrong place. She's supposed to be number one in the world. God has number three.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think.
Brother Kobe. Black woman.
Pain. Loving. Provider.
Brother Therese, black woman.
My mama, my daughter, my auntie.
Brother Tavares, black woman.
Loving, caring, support system.
Yes.
And if you're wrong, she's going to let you know.
Conscious, that's
right. Yes, sir.
An aura, black woman.
Strong,
yes.
Beautiful,
yes.
Caring,
yes.
Nurturing,
yes.
Awesome. Pastor Wardell, black woman,
queen,
yes.
Strong, backbone of the family,
yes. Yes.
Awesome. For myself, queen, my mother, my first choice.
Wow, that's good. I like that.
Choice.
That's good.
My only choice. Thank you. Man, Brother Andre, black woman.
Definitely strong. Supported. In so many words, in so many situations, I can say God fear.
Yes.
And a mother to all.
Yes.
Because it's got a lot of them that mother a lot more than just these kids.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
All right. This is kind of fun. It's going to get a little more interesting in a second. Great black leaders. On order.
Barack Obama.
And let me say something before she. This don't mean you have to name four of them. Just whatever comes to mind. No, you're not wrong. I want to honest the first stuff that comes to your mind I say great black leaders. And that's fine. You said Barack Obama. So great black leaders. You got Barack Obama. Continue.
My father.
That's right. Absolutely. Real tall. All right. Brother Tavares. Great black leaders.
Say, Malcolm X.
Yeah.
Farrakhan. Mm-hmm. Dick Gregory.
Mm-hmm.
Martin Luther King.
Awesome. Brother Therese. Great black leaders.
Failure, rejection, disappointment, power.
Awesome, awesome. Brother Kobe, great black leaders.
Thurgood Marshall. Mm-hmm. Pastors, my own, Reverend Shivers. Mm-hmm. Coaches, because most of the time, it's only black people in the school system.
Mm-hmm.
Brother Gill.
You know my daddy, number one. You were shocked.
Right.
And the majority of the stuff I start out with says, well, my daddy said, you know what I'm saying? So my father, Gil Muse Sr., you know, that's number one. Then number two, my hero today is Mr. Brian Stevenson.
Okay.
He is a black man who just went into the court system to help our young people who have been sentenced to life. At 14 and 15 and 12 and year old, 10 years old. You know what I'm saying? And put up a giant fight. He exposed how the lynching then went down in this country and everything and continues to do things that's powerful and uplifting. This man is the reason why I stayed in this fight. Okay? And then Mr. Thurgood Marshall. That's like my hero of all heroes, because when black folks couldn't be lawyers, when black folks couldn't have no legal representation, this man had the audacity to show up in a courtroom and not just represent black folks, but win. And then not only that, in a time when we were still trying to fight to be a human being, this man laid up there and made it to the Supreme Court. You understand? This man showed everybody that, and everybody should look him up, that we can make the laws.
All right. Brother Andre, great black leaders.
I'm gonna put a preface on it. Pastors with integrity and character, fathers with integrity and character, politicians, black politicians, with integrity and character.
Mm-hmm.
My father.
One of the viewers was saying that the panel needs to learn their black leaders, but that might have been before she heard my actual acknowledgement of the fact that they didn't have to be just people. Whatever came to mind when you heard the phrase black leader. So for me, I would say assassinated black fathers, Barack Obama, my father. Brother Wardell, great black leaders.
So Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Yes, yes.
Barack Obama. My father, Pastor Ward L. Dyson Jr.
Awesome. Now this is going to be a little bit more challenging. And it's important for me to go through them because they all have their own place. And it's the reason why I'm asking them. Because it gives, really you don't realize these questions, they actually show, they illustrate kind of what was promoted or pushed or propagated in your life to think when you heard these terms. And it may not be always right, and if you had time to think about them a little bit deeper, you probably would change some. But the whole intent was to not give you opportunity to think about it.
It hurted me. It took me about 5 seconds to even think.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. But that's all right. Now this one here, Starving Brother Wardell, our future as Black Americans.
Yeah, like our future as Black Americans, we can be whatever we want to be. Sky's the limit. Don't let nobody tell you different. We could be the next entrepreneur. We could be the next governor of a state, president of the United States.
Right.
We could be everything that we want to be, long as we put our mind to it. Most importantly, we have to put God on.
For me, I would say hopeful, but sometimes bleak. I would say changing. I would also say it's prophetic. Andre, our future as Black Americans.
Kingdom minded. Progressive in our thinking. Progressive in our education, progressive in the raising of our children in our home, and progressive in our businesses.
Brother Gil, our future as Black Americans, in four words that come to mind.
Because of the current state of affairs, and my 48, about to be 49 years of living, subjugated, assimilated, and conquered.
Brother Kobe, our future as Black Americans.
Cloudy. Mm-hmm. Unknown.
Yes,
fear. Hopeful.
Brother Perez, our future as Black Americans.
Jeremiah 29:11. That's what I gotta go off of. We gonna be prosperous. Mm-hmm. We ain't gonna be in want for nothing. We gonna be right where we need to be. Mm-hmm. Cause we gonna be in God.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Brother Tavares, our future as Black Americans.
Jeremiah 29:11.
Rulers.
Yes,
awesome,
sir.
Awesome, Lord.
Decision making.
Yes, yes.
Wealthy.
Awesome, bro.
Yeah. I like that. And healthy if possible.
Awesome, yeah. Man. That's good.
I like
growth,
that.
Man. That's great, man.
That's good.
But Aura, our future as Black Americans.
Leaders.
Mm-hmm.
Ambitious.
Mm-hmm.
Educated.
Wow.
She just put us on.
Christians.
Awesome. Yeah, that made me feel good.
Awesome.
Wow.
Now this is a fill in the blank. Growing up in America right now gives me or makes me what? Start with Brother Gil Mews. Growing up in America right now gives me or makes me what?
Growing up in America right now gives me pause. Makes me proud to be a Black man because I have seen so many Black men walking with their children, young Black men. And that's going to pay major dividends 10, 20 years from now, especially in the city of New Orleans.
Yeah.
And I tell them all the time, I think we are going to overcome, but it's only going to be amongst word of mouth. The television is still going to, and the radio is still going to be picking us how we want to.
Awesome, awesome. Brother Kobe, growing up in America right now either gives me or it makes me what?
Growing up in America now gives me fear, but not knowing how the future, what the future holds.
Brother Therese, growing up in America right now gives me or makes me what?
It makes me trust God more.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Great, great, great. Brother Tavares, growing up in America right now gives me or makes me what?
More confident in myself.
Awesome, man. Awesome.
That's good.
Opportunities. That's
make me want to be more of a leader.
Awesome.
Make me want to do better.
That's right.
I know people watching everything I do.
Right.
From the little kids up to the old folks.
Right.
So make me wise in my decision thing.
That's what's up, man. That's great. An aura. Growing up in America right now gives me or makes me what?
Fearful.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Fearful and not knowing.
Brother Wardell, growing up in America right now gives me or makes me what?
Strength. It made me strengthen and know that I could do all things through Christ who strengthened me.
Hey.
Awesome, man. Growing up in America right now, for me, it gives me concern. But I'm very optimistic, so therefore, it gives me lots of hope, too. Brother Andre, growing up in America right now gives me or makes me what?
Growing up in America gives me the perspective of opportunity and makes me very thankful to God for those opportunities.
Mm-hmm. Opportunities.
Can I say one thing?
Go ahead.
When I would feel like fearful and because I don't know tomorrow. Like I used to be like these pastors and these ministers and deacons that be quoting these scriptures, everything it gotta be a scripture. Give me something regular. But I'm learning that's the influence. That's the encouragement. So I really been applying myself in the Bible. So when I feel fearful, I go in the Word. Lord said, don't be afraid. And not only that, he said, he told us not to lean to our own understanding. We're not going to understand. We got to walk in his promises. When you walk in God's promises, you're not saying you don't see nothing or you don't feel nothing. But what you're saying is you trust in God. And because of your act of trust, God will always make sure he see you through. I'm a living witness.
Awesome.
Yeah, feedback.
Mm-hmm.
Scriptures does say too that God has not given us a spirit of fear.
That's right.
But of power, love, and of a sound mind, meaning that you have your sanity. If God doesn't give us fear, who does? The devil. That is the question.
Right.
The devil.
That's right.
So the opposite of fear is faith. If he's given us faith, that's what we have to stand on as people, as human beings. With all the stuff going on, pandemic, sicknesses, and diseases, he told me in his word that none of that stuff will come near me. So if my faith is, if that faith is built on those words, then I don't live in that fear of getting sick. Most of the fear happens because anxiety hits because you think you're going to get it. And when fear is coupled with sickness, it overtakes you. So just to piggyback off that, I just wanted to say that, man. Yeah. Like, that fear factor thing, that ain't of God.
No.
Right. If we in God, we don't fear that stuff. Anyway.
Hey, and Paul, when he wrote the first letter to Corinthians, he was on this journey, one of his missionary journeys. He got word that Corinthian so, you know, Paul had a thorn in his flesh. Paul would often cry out. And I'm saying this to tell you this.
when you think you fearful, if you just somehow, if you could just, you know, because when you fear weak, it ties in the same hand. All right. So if you in that area of life, if you could just think of one scripture that will show God that you believe in his work, and he'll do the miraculous. He shows himself his best through us at our weakest time.
We're getting close to wrapping up today, but I wanted two more on that same vein, the same subject, then we'll move on to the last little part. But if you could change anything in the country right now, and this ain't got to be for everybody, you know, I can just get like one or two of you guys that want to jump on this one, because you might expound on it a little bit. But if you could change anything in this country right now, what would it be? Do I have anybody that wants that?
If I could change anything in this world, it would be police brutality. It would be the black-on-black crime. It would be of us disrespecting our black women, mm-hmm, and degrading them and calling them out of their names and right, all that kind of stuff. That's what I would change, because I believe that if we get back to the basics and the foundations of living and life, we'll live as a principle of how God wants us to live, and something, all of those other things will cease.
Awesome. Mine quick. I just would like to get rid of the systematic oppression. Let us start at the same yard line. Let us start at the 1 yard line together. And if you beat me then, you deserve to win. But if you start off at the 60, and we only go in the 70, and I'm starting at the goal line, it's unfair, and I kind of don't like that. That's what part that comes to my point. So if anybody else wanted that or not, Mr. Gill?
If I could change anything in this world, I just want to change one thing. I just would like that when everybody go to sleep, they get baptized, they wake up washed in the blood, and be believers in Jesus, be followers of Christ. And once that happened, this world and all of the trouble and everything that's going on with it will just cease to exist. If I could change, that's what I would do.
Awesome. This is a question that you hear a lot. Well, no, before I get to that, I'm going to say this. I got to use this one because this is a big one. Because it's the same question twice. And I'm going to say what I mean. Police department, law enforcement. What are the words that come to mind? But before I stop right there, I want to ask first, in the general sense, what, as it relates, not as it relates to our topic today. So when you hear police department, law enforcement, disregarding what we know is going on, in the general sense, what are the first words that come to mind? Then I'm going to ask you, what are the first words that come to mind as it relates to where we find ourselves today? So when you hear police department, law enforcement, in its general sense, in its basic fundamental sense, what are the words that come to mind? Anybody can take that.
State sanctioned murder.
Protection.
Protection. That's your general sense.
Trustworthy.
Trustworthy. General sense, serve and protect. That's my general sense.
I was gonna say, you know, serve and protect.
But when
can
you
I,
think,
can I say
go
this?
Ahead, go ahead.
I have my opinion formulated from growing up in that St. Bernard Hospital, mm-hmm, right there. Okay? Mm-hmm. So, I don't want nobody to think I'm being doom and gloom.
There is doom and gloom.
Well, you were going to get to say that on the next.
That's doom and gloom.
The opposite backside of the question.
I'm just messing with you.
Right.
You're going to get to say it. So now if you take that same statement, or same question, and say police department, law enforcement, as it relates to our topic today, anybody want that? A couple of words that come to mind. We're getting close to wrapping it up.
Still state sanctioned.
That's why
killer.
I fit that better.
Lost, because I have like three, I know like three police officers that come from my school. We weren't friends, but they come from my school, but I kind of know them. So it's more like a lot of these police officers, they come from normal houses. It's like they come in and get bullied.
Right.
And they scared on two sides. That's why I feel like we should be more understanding and have a little more peace, because they got two sides they facing.
I grew up with two guys that both said they were going to be police officers in that St. Bernard Housing Project.
One of them name was Brinky. And from the time we was little bitty kids, Brinky said that he was going to grow up and be a police officer. He was going to rob all the drug dealers. He said he was going to do whatever he was going to do because he saw the other police officers doing that, and he knew that's what he wanted to do. He wind up making the news here in New Orleans with several other police officers when they finally did sting and the FBI ran in on him. And he did just what he said he was going to do as a child standing in that St. Bernard housing plateau. Okay? Then I have another friend named Danielle, who mother made sure he came inside when the sun was going down. You knew it. Sometimes he couldn't even come outside and play ball with us. Here's a cat who had 3 squares a day, mild demeanor, good guy, type of person you meet and you say, I don't mind if you date my daughter. And one day, while I was at school in Delgado, he came up to me and was talking to me about how they sick the dog on some human beings, let the dog, his words, get a little chew toy. And I had to turn to him and tell him, you grew up in that project with me. You know how the people are, and you grew up and became part of the problem. You understand me? So, you know, I digress. I forgot why I was telling you that.
I wanted to say this, and on top of all that, there are some awesome police officers. Mm-hmm. Like, man, just stop. And if we want to stand up and take up for each other, do it in your hood. I'm sorry, but I mean it. Mm-hmm. We gotta do better for ourselves, man. Like, we always trying to find something else, and it be us. Mm-hmm. I'm saying, like, yeah. If you want to be like that, oh, they just stood around standing. This is the perfect time to tell yourself, I'm finna read as much law as I can. Mm-hmm. And because if you have the intellectual capacity, you could be telling him some things in the book and could shook him. And he probably would have just called his supervisor. Mm-hmm. But instead, what we do? We gotta stop, man. It goes back to the Bible. Mm-hmm. We supposed to be peacemakers, man. And like, a lot of my friends don't agree with this, what I'm talking about. But I know this gonna happen because the life that I'm living, the life that I'm trying my best to live, it comes with this. Mm-hmm. I gotta be truthful. Yeah. We must be peaceful. Mm-hmm. Because anything outside of peace, yeah, is outside of God. It ain't gonna never work.
What you said about the brothers and not wanting to hear what you just said, okay, about being good in the neighborhood to each other and everything like that, we give each other bad advice. We've been programmed to do the wrong thing with each other. I had a guy pull a gun on me in New Orleans, and he didn't realize it was the crime cameras up there watching, and I pointed it out to him. Then I told him I was going to call the police on him. And the guys that was with me told me not to call the police on him. You know, I agree with you 100%.
It's everything. And yes. I got to, this real fast, real promise. Quick, man. Yes. We got to change everything, man, because we don't supposed to impress somebody. I understand that. But, man, we walk around here, man, like, we look like what they say. I know it's not about the clothes, but it is to a certain degree, man. We got to change a lot, man, before we even try to stand up.
In regards to that last statement right there, I have different thoughts about it. But I do know that it comes from a state of not ever having nothing, or having anything. So when we see people in passing, we want them to know everything about us in only a few seconds of passing. So if I'm at the red light and that's all you see of me, you don't even know me, but I want you to know everything that I own and have in one passing. And that's because of our nature of never having enough. But it's still something we have to break though. We need to, but there's nothing wrong with having a style, a quote unquote swag, because we set trends. Black people are culture setters, we trend setters, and we spend big dollars in most markets in the world in different arenas, but we just don't focus or prioritize them in the areas that will be more beneficial to our people. So when I say that, I mean in banking, in home, real estate, in schools, in education, stuff like that, in our infrastructure, in our communities. I think that collectively we should do better than that, because I don't have the numbers in front of me, but I've seen before that we spend trillions of dollars a year on things that don't benefit us. They lose value. They are depreciating assets. So I wanted to say that, and we're getting ready to wrap it up.
You gonna wrap it up?
What you got?
The Bible said, the king's heart is in the hands of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
If we truly want justice, we want things to change, we need to pray more and come on one accord and do right by God, and he'll do the miraculous.
Right. I got a question. It's just a one question. I don't need but one person to answer. And then I'm going to get to my last 30 to 45 second commentary for everybody to go around and say what they would like to leave for the viewers, and especially our young black men today after we conclude this show. But I hear all the time that they think that we just, since we're not quote unquote living in slavery and quote unquote Jim Crow era supposedly is gone, what are we complaining about? So a lot of times we hear the question, do we complain too much? Do anybody believe that black people complain too much? And I want one person to answer that as we get ready to conclude the show.
Yes.
And you don't even have to give the substantiating background info on it. I just wanted to hear, do you agree?
Because I do. I still do.
Yes.
I got to work on that.
All right, we're getting ready to conclude it. Before we close, I'm going to go around, and we really need to try to make this within 30 seconds to 45 seconds. I want each one of you to give the viewers what you would like to share with them and leave them with as we conclude this show. And especially our young black men. Starting with my Aunt Aura, this is our last 30 to 45 second commentary for the whole panel as we get ready to conclude this show. What is it that you would like to leave with our viewers, and more specifically, our young black men, after the show concludes?
I know what I tell my son. I know he's working with Dixie, and he drive, I guess with all this other stuff going on with him, he kind of nervous, a little paranoid, whatever, but I tell him. I say, if you ever get stopped, and I hope young men, it doesn't matter. It ain't all about your attitude and all this. What you stopping me for?
Right.
Why you doing this? And like I tell him, all I want you to do, make it home. Say yes, sir. What I need, sir? Do you need my license? Do you need my insurance? Is it okay if I reach for them?
Right.
Can I reach for them?
That's right.
Reach for them, give it to them. Yes, sir. No, sir. All we need you all to do is to make it home.
Just make it.
Make it home. Try not to be boastful. Once you get home and you think you was profiled at that point, then we can handle it from there.
Absolutely. Brother Tavares, what would you like to leave the viewers with in 30 to 45 seconds on today, and especially our young black men? And our black men in general, however you want to phrase it.
Get to know God. Self-educate yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Right in your environment.
Awesome.
Surroundings.
Awesome. Brother Therese.
I'm out.
All right, man. My phone might cut off in the middle.
Jesus
of 1%, so.
Is the way. He also has the truth. And in him is life. So all those areas, that's what we're trying to find. And it's in Jesus.
Awesome. Brother Kobe.
Our life must be faith driven.
Yes.
And we must also not give up. Whenever you proceed to try to follow on and push forward, you're going to make it.
Yes, sir.
Brother Gil, real quick, it's on 1%.
Young people, the way to beat this abject poverty, the way to beat this degradation and all this humiliation that you're constantly facing is to knuckle down hard in those books so that we can become professionals, so that we can become keepers of our own communities. Through hard work, we will get there. But above all, remember, we can do nothing without Jesus.
Brother Water,
you are loved. Keep your head up. Trust in the foundation and the beliefs in God.
For lack of time, I will skip that and get straight to the end. We enjoyed you guys. I hope you got something from it. Remember, it's not about being liked. It's not even about how people feel. But whatever you say, bring passion, show respect. But most importantly, keep it real. And this is a real talk, human discussions. And we out.
Another one in the book.
Thank y'all.